Yeah, so if your virtual machine is already started, you have to just right click on this one, click on VM Player. Okay, I right click on this one and click on VM Player. So it opens up this new window again. So wherein I see two of these things. Does everybody see both of them? Everybody, do you guys see it? If somebody doesn't see it, all you need to do is go to open a virtual machine. Because by default, it's not by default. So you have to first time open this one. From then on, it remembers it. If you do not open it multiple times, then it doesn't remember. So all you need to do is, if you do not see this Red Hat Linux here, click on open a virtual machine. And in your folder, wherever they dumped that folder, right? The Krishna Training 40 GB dump, wherever they stored it, right? Log into that folder and you see something called Red Hat Linux. Can you guys see it? Whoever don't have that one there. So when you open it up, you'll see this file. Virtual machine where virtual file, VMware file. I can do that again. So click on open the virtual machine. If you guys do not have this Red Hat Linux here, click on virtual machine and go to the Krishna Training folder wherever they have all your files saved. You'll see a file called Red Hat Linux. Double click that one and you will see this virtual machine file. You have to click on that and click on open. Then you will see this one. Yeah, you guys have it? Now click on play virtual machine. So before it starts, how many of you know why do we use Unix or why do we learn Unix? What is Unix? What is Unix? It's an operating system. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I'll discuss. So you'll get to this window. Is everybody here?
Yeah.
So we can pick any user we want, but I mean, I'm going to go with the Krishna Training 1 user. Click on that one. It's going to ask for the password. It's the same password, never give up. And log in. What is it?
My computer cursor coming in is stored after that cannot work. And then they reinstall that something. Since they didn't, you say like this screen, I can never find it. I don't know. I think maybe you can.
Yeah. So are you guys in this screen right now?
Yes.
So all we need to do is we will be accessing something called terminal. This is the only thing that we'll be accessing in Unix. Okay, all your commands, everything that you write will be in terminal. How do we access that? If you do not have it here, then you can go to applications, system tools, and terminal. If you want it on your desktop, hold that, drag it onto the desktop. It will come up. Okay, I asked you guys a question about why do we use Unix? No answer? Copying files. Faster than what? When you double click this one, there opens up a window. So this is where we write our Unix commands. So this is called terminal. Okay. So before we start doing anything with Unix, let me first draw up some diagrams and let's start with understanding why we need Unix as a QA. Okay. Let me go find paint. So for example, we are in a, we have a system. This is our system. I'll name it PC1. Okay. So let's say there is a system. It's called PC1. And you're accessing our okay. Everybody downloads music, movies online? Mm-hmm. You guys do it? Mm-hmm. Now, let's say you have a movie that you want to download. Where do you go download? Let's say it's stored in some other server. It can be any website. It has a server. It stores a dump over there. Is that right? Some third party vendor or some third party torrent site, they have the movies stored out there. I'll say server. Okay. So from your personal laptop, you will connect to the server and then download that particular file. Is that right? Is it what we do? In general. I'm talking about in general, whatever we do. So we have our own PC machine. We have the server. We connect to the server and download files from there. Let me take a better example. Let's say we have cloud. Do you guys know what is cloud systems these days? There are a lot of people talk about cloud, right? I can take an example of Amazon or Google. Let's take Google Drive. What is this? A space where you can store all your files and folders. Yes? How do we access it? We access it from your personal machine. You have to have a PC to access that machine. Is that right? Now, can we access this drive from any system? If we have, what? Okay, let's say we have internet connect after that. What should we need to access the system? I can access it from any PC. But what are the things that I need? The address to this Google Drive, the username, and password. When I have all these three combinations exactly the way I set it up, only then I can log into this one and extract the files. Is that right? Mm-hmm. So this is what we do in a job too. So we don't have any Google Drive or anything, but what we do is whenever we move the data from one place to another place, I've been talking about source files, target, and we load it into target eventually, right? So all the source files that you get, sometimes we get the file, load it into the database, and you test it against the database. Sometimes we do not load it into the database, and you might have to test it directly from the file. Okay, source file, it can be a XML file, it can be a text file, or any other type. File is what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the database here, okay? File is different, right? So those files, when you get it from source, source is what? You get it from some other vendors, and then load the data into your database. Is that right? So when you get the data from other vendors, generally what they do is they do not send you the files directly. That means, how do we generally send a file? Email. We send it through emails, right? That is how we share it. If you want to send some document to her, what do? You send her an email, right? So generally, I think emails, they never send out any emails, because the maximum size that they can send out probably is 10 MB. Is that right? That I believe 10 MB is the max size that is in Google Gmail. So it's not practical for you, or it's not safe for somebody to send files through email, because there'll be huge amounts of data. The files will be in GB, millions and millions of records. It's not practical to send it out emails. So what they try to do is they have a server machine. The source or the company might have a server machine. I'll name it server. And the people who are working on this one, on a project, on this project, will be given access to the server machine. So let's say there is a project manager, PM. There is a BA. There is a developer. There is a QA. Probably architect. So these are all the different positions that we have in a company, right? On a high level. So everybody will have his own PC, his own username, password, right? So when you go to a company, in order to access the company systems, you should be having access to those systems. Is that right? Nobody can log in to system directly. You have to have the access. So there'll be a team which provides you the access. Similarly, there are server machines here. Okay, they'll give you the address of the server machine. And if you want to log into that server machine from your machine, you need to have access given to it. Okay, when you have access, the only way you connect to these server machines 90% of the times is Unix. And we as a QA will be using Unix to copy the files. File transfer protocol. This is what we generally do. FTP. We copy the files, we send the files. That is what we do with Unix. We do not compare anything. We can compare data too in Unix. It is something like a language. Whatever SQL that we learned, right? Whatever we did, most of the stuff we can do it in Unix too. Okay, but we are not playing with tables here. I'm playing with files. Okay? Now, Unix is an operating system, as I said, and this is our main use. When we have a server machine, you need to log into the server machine and extract the data from your local machine. You send the data to the server machine.
So mainly to send files.
Mainly to copy files, yes.
Like IP addresses.
Yes. So I just gave an example of Google Drive, right? What are the three things that you need? Website address, right? Website, username, valid username and password, right? These are the three things that you need in order to log into any drive. And these are the three things that we need in order to log into a server machine. But we name it a little different here. We'll have the host address, that's what we call it. This one doesn't change. Username, password. Okay? It is safe and easy. See, generally, why? Because all the server machines, they're not stored in Unix. The operating system that we have in server machines are Unix. It's not Windows. Okay, in order to access a Unix machine, you need to run commands in Unix. Unix is safe. It doesn't have the load that you have on the system is very less. It's free of bugs. It's very hard to crack into a Unix framework and create a bug. So the it's virus free, actually. That's what I can say. So all the server machines, 90% of the time, so all the Informatica that you see, all the tools, everything will be installed on a server, and the servers have operating system that to be Unix. You'll be accessing those machines from a Windows machine. Okay? All you get is Windows when you go to job. If you give a Unix machine, can you work on it? Nobody knows, right? I don't know how to work on a Unix machine. If they ask me to test something. So, server machines is different, personal laptops are different. I'm just trying to make that point here. Okay, we have server machine. The server machine, the operating system is Unix. So on that Unix machine, if we have a file stored, anything, you log in through Unix and try to extract those files. Make sense? And another good thing that I want to say here is, there are right now a lot of new graphic user interface tools, GUI tools, out there in the market. So not everybody uses all these commands these days. There are companies right now where we can just play around something like this. This will be your personal laptop folder, and you log into your server machine. There'll be a folder like this. So you just hold it and drag it onto your machine. This is your server machine, this is your local machine. This is a folder on your local machine. When I mean by that, there's a folder on your remote machine. Hold it and drag it onto this. That's how simple these days. You do not need all the Unix commands, but there are still some companies which run on Unix. That is why we learn it. Okay? When you log into this one, right? You don't need to log in now, right now. I'm not explaining anything. When you log into any of these, Windows machine or anything, is it installing your system? The Informatica and everything? The Windows machine that you see, the Toad, the database, is it installed in your local machine? Where is it installed? It's installed in a Krishna training server. All these softwares, everything. He's sending you dump, but generally what happens is everything is installed in the database is installed in the Krishna training. There's a room out there with bunches of servers. Every time it runs. So whenever you log in, if you need to run something, right? Typically it executes back from the database. How do we do it? On a server machine, we store everything that runs 24 hours. Whenever you want to access, you just log into the server and you can see that running. Okay, the Informatica, I can give you another example for Informatica. When you have Informatica workflows, right? last weekend we ran some workflows, yes? So we have that workflows. When we run a workflow, it just ran in 2 or 3 seconds, isn't it? With the transformation that we had, it just ran in 2 or 3 seconds. Now if we have a workflow, generally the workflow runs for hours. Let's say a person ran a workflow starting at 4 o'clock in the evening from his personal laptop when he's in work. Okay, it might run for 6 hours, 7 hours. You cannot sit in the office for that much time, right? If he closes it, he's going to crash the workflow because he stops it, right? So typically what they do is whenever they have workflows, they do not run it on their personal machines. They run it in servers. Because servers, even though if you close your laptop, personal laptop, servers are sitting at a place and they're always running. So you run your workflow in the server, you close your machine, go back home and log into the server, you're still seeing that. So that is what a server, it's a cloud environment which is not related to you. You have to log into that machine. Okay? In order to log into another machine, we use Unix. Okay? There are different tools to access a Unix machine. So Unix, to log into any computer or network, all you need is 3 things. Host name, host address, username and password. Isn't it? Is that right? Just consider this as a website. In order to log into a website, you need these three. What is the website that you're logging in? Username and password. Similarly, log into any network, you need the IP address or the host address. Right? So, the tool that we generally use in companies to log into the server machine is PuTTY. Have you guys ever seen this file? No? Okay, this is how the file looks. PuTTY. When I open that, this is the window that you will see in general. Any company, if you open up PuTTY, this is what you see. Okay? Host address or the IP address. Click on open. Is going to ask for username and password. Okay? So generally what we give the IP address here and click on open. So it's going to open up a window where you give your username and password, and that's how you connect to the server machine. So whatever address that you give here is the destination address that you want to connect. Okay? So PuTTY is a tool that will help you connect to the server machine. So once you connect to a server machine, what do you do? We don't know. So in order to write a command, what do we need to do? There'll be multiple tasks that we could do on a server machine. So for doing what should we do on that one is what we are going to learn in the class. That is the Unix commands. So if you write what command, what it does. We know, we learned SQL, why? To extract data from the database. Right? Similarly, if you want to access a Unix machine, there are specific commands that you need to run in a specific way. Only then it runs. Okay? So right now, we have virtual machine here with Unix. Consider this as a server. So that's why I do not need to connect to any remote servers. I already have the terminal. So if I log in with the IP address, username and password, I'll be logging like this. I'll get to this window.
So basically, if you have VPN installed on your machine, this is what you would come, you would enter the IP address at that point?
Yes. Okay? Is that clear? Mm-hmm. Until here? Now, do you guys know this already? You guys know it, right? Okay. So there is something called Unix prompt. Dollar symbol in Unix is called Unix prompt. Try to remember this one because this is gonna be very handy in Unix. So whenever you open up a terminal, right? So we are logged into a server machine. Assume that we are logged into server machine. This is how it looks. You guys see it? Can you able to see it or? I'll increase the font. Clear? Okay. So whenever you log into terminal, right? This is a Unix prompt that we need to look for. Okay. If you do not see this Unix prompt, that means you are not logged in properly, or the system is not ready to type in any commands. That is what I can say. Okay. Whenever you log into the terminal, if you want to execute any command, you should see the dollar symbol. If you do not see the dollar symbol, that means that your system is not ready to type any command. And what is the username that I logged in? Krishna Training 1, right? So this is what it says, Krishna Training 1. That is the user. Add that particular address. Okay, so this is the server address. Right now, I have everything in my local machine, so I'm not worried about the server address. But eventually, when you log into a particular host address, it'll be the username, add the rate, the address. Okay? This is all background before we start writing our test commands. The next thing that I want to explain here is this one, the symbol. What is this called?
Tilde.
Tilde, right? The symbol like this. So whenever you see this symbol, so Krishna Training, @localhost, and the symbol, that means you are in your home folder. There is something called home folder. I'll explain all these things in detail. When I say home folder, all this time I've been saying that I need username, password, and the address. Yes? So when I use the username, password, and address and log into a system, where should I land? I'll be logging into my home folder. So whenever I first log into a server machine, I'll be logging into my home folder. When I say home folder, let me open up this address. Documents, Cam Studio, media. That is the address, isn't it? I went into multiple folders here. Okay? If somebody asks you to direct you to this folder, what do you do? Will you say go to PC, downloads, documents, or give this address? What does this address mean? This is in C drive. You use this folder, in users folder, go to this folder, and you go to media. That's how you navigate to media folder, isn't it?
Yeah.
That is the address of this folder. This is the path of this folder. Okay? Similarly, when somebody logs into a server machine, there'll be folder structure. Obviously, there'll be folder structure. You have to land somewhere, right? So when you log into a server machine, you'll log into something like this, a path. That path is called your home address. So whenever you log in to the server machine, if you are in your home folder, you'll get the symbol. If you're not in home folder, it will specify what is the folder that is logged in. Okay? But when you see the symbol, by default, it means that you are logged into your home folder. So when I log into my home folder, I'll explain what this command is. This is where I land right now. /home/KrishnaTraining. This is the folder I logged in, right? The username that I logged in. So there are a bunch of usernames here. Don't worry about this. I'm going to just show you. These are all the users that we looked at in that screen, right? We had Krishna Training until 11, 12, whatever we have. So these are all the users. But we logged in where? This user, isn't it? So when we logged in this user, by default, it will take us to the home path. This is my home directory. That is what? When I say home directory, this is where I'm /home/KrishnaTraining1. You have to remember these terms. Home directory. Okay? Directory is called folder. Directory. See, when I was okay, let me show it once again. I'm showing you the commands, but that's okay. I'm in home/KrishnaTraining1, right? I'll go a step backward and type pwt. I'm in my home folder right now. Don't worry about the commands. I'm going to explain about the commands. All I'm trying to show is the way the folder structure is. I'm in my home folder right now, isn't it? So in this home directory, I have all these users. Yes? So when I'm in my home directory, what is it showing here? Which means that I'm in my home directory. It's not, I would say, if you have a different name here, that name will be here. It's not home. It's a different home here. When I say my actual thing, this is my home address. Isn't it? For the user, this is my home address. home/KrishnaTraining1. How do I know? With this symbol. So I'm going to log into KrishnaTraining1 now. If you can see, I got back my tilde symbol. That means if I find the address right now, this is the address that I logged in. The user is in this address right now. Make sense? Let's look at the commands now one by one. So before we do that, we have some other things that we need to discuss. There are three types of permissions that we get for a user. Read, write, and execute. How many of you know this? Have you guys heard about it? For any file,
not in Unix, rather stuff.
Any stuff, it's generalized stuff. In general, for a file, we'll have, or for a user, we'll have read, write, and execute. And these permissions can be dependent on a file. So let's say you have a PDF document. Can you edit that document?
No.
It's a read-only document. So that is a type of access. So there can be files in Unix where we can specify read, write, and execute access. Execute will only work for any executable files. But read and write is read only, and this is edit permissions. Okay. These are notated as R, W, X. R means read, W means write, X means execute. These have a lot of importance because this is what you see. You do not see read, write, execute. You'll always see R, W, X. So make sure that you know what R is, what W is, what X is. And they also assign numbers for R. For R, it's 4, W it's 2, X is 1. Okay? This is the definition. This is how they are defined. We cannot change these numbers. For read, it's R and the number is 4. Write, W and 2, X and 1 for execute.
So does it come up as R4 or what is the number indicating?
I'll tell you. All you need to know is read is 4, W is 2, and X is 1. When R, W, X is read, write, execute. Okay, so when they have a number, or when they store something for a file, when they assign permissions, so they'll have a file name, and they'll say read, write, execute. These are the permissions that they have. For this particular file, read, write, execute is what they give. For example, there are three type of people. user, group, and other. What does user mean? The person who is using it. Group, your team. Others, anybody other than your team. Is that right? So there are three people. One is user, one is group, one is others. Right? User should have all the permissions. He should be able to read, write, and execute. Yes? Group should have what? They should be able to read and probably write. Okay? The final user should have only read. They cannot execute anything. Is that right? Other than you, nobody should execute. Generally, in typical, I'm talking about, if you have a file, you do not want anybody to edit it. What do? You just give them read-only access. So that is what this means. User, group, other. U, G, and O. Those are the denominations. U, G, that's okay. It's up to us. Whatever permissions. Do we have different permissions out there? In this, I can give it. But DBS do it. You don't need to worry about it, but we can discuss about some commands. So, for example.
Is this case sensitive?
Yes. Good point. Unix is case sensitive. Everything that you write is in small letters. If you write in capital letters, it will not work. Now you know user, group, others, isn't it? Fine. So what we'll do is, we'll try to come up with some example. You guys know read, write, execute, and we have user, group, and others. Fine? So if we have a file called training.txt. We have a file called training.txt. Okay? So we have to assign, or we have to let the computer know that user should have some properties, group should have some properties, others should have some properties. This is a file, and this file has those properties. Okay? In order to assign those properties, what we generally, how at the end, how does it look as txt? Let's say, what are the properties that you want to give it to user? All the properties, right? R, W, X, space. What are the properties for group? Let's say read and write. R, W, hyphen, space. For others, read only. Two hyphens. Because we should have three characters. If you do not have one, we'll put with hyphen. We have read, write, X for user. So this is how we give it. U, G, and O. That is the order you need to give. For user, I have read, write, X. For group, I have read, write, hyphen. That means I have only read and write. For training, others, I have read only. I do not have any others.
So if we give read and execute, then R-X
is what we. This is how we give it. Okay? I'm just showing you how a file has properties. This is not the way you assign it, but I'll show you how to assign it. But a file has three properties which we give for user, for group, and others. For user we'll have all read, write, execute. For group we'll have read and write. For others we can have. There's possibility that everybody will have all the accesses. Then what do we have? RWX, RWX, and RWX. That means all the three people, all the three groups have all the access for that particular document. Make sense? Yes? No, space. This is one group, this is one group, this is one group. So we also assigned numbers to it, right? What did we say? 4, 2, 1. Isn't it? If I need to replace the above thing with numbers, how can I do it? 4, 2, 1. If you add up what? What do we get if I add up everything?
7.
For this one?
6.
For this one?
5.
This is another way of writing it. This is another way of writing it. First one is for user, group, others, because read is 4, write is 4, write is 2, execute is 1. When I add 4 plus 2 plus 1, I get 7. 4 plus 2, I get 6. 4 plus 1, I get 5. So this is another way of assigning properties to a particular file. Okay? We'll discuss a lot more about these stuff, but all you need to know is this is how we write it. For now. Okay? Read, write, and execute. And the last step that I want to discuss before we start with the commands is the slash. We have been telling slash folder name slash, right? In Unix, this is called root. The slash is called root. Unix prompt is what we call for dollar, right? Dollar is what is called Unix prompt, and slash is called root. Okay, and the address, whenever we log into the home folder, home slash the username. Isn't it? That is where we log in, right? I said again, Unix is case sensitive and every single command is in small letters. I'll share this document too. So, and it's already in Krishna training if you guys want to look at it. All right. Is it clear? Mm-hmm. Are we ready?
Yes.
Let's start with command. It'll be pretty easy. I'm telling you. When compared to SQL, it'll be very easy. The Unix. All you need to remember is the commands. If you remember the commands, what it does, it's pretty easy. Now, until now, I've been saying the home address, right? So pwd is my first command. Let me know if you guys want to take a break. PWD is my first command. It gives me the path of the folder that I'm currently working on. My current working folder. So if I log into my home folder, that is my current working folder, isn't it? If I log into a specific folder, isn't it my current working folder? So PWD is a command that always gives you the path. Let me run it. You guys can try if you want to. So I've logged into my machine. Type pwd. It's giving me something. It is the address of the current working directory. Okay? So this is where I am in this particular folder. Can you guys do it? Is it simple? Finding the address? That is our first command. It'll be like this. Pretty easy. Next thing. Clear. What do you think it does? It clears the screen. So let me type something. Okay, now I do clear. Clears the complete screen. What does it do? It will delete everything. Then?
Gets you back to your home directory.
It just scrolls down. It just scrolls down. Everything will be still there. It just clears the screen. It's going to come down. It just scrolls down.
If I'm forced to bring something, I go one day, I want to be made there. I use clear, right? I need it slightly clear on the top sentence or from the back sentence.
Whenever you type something, any command that you type.
Yeah. I want to except the one person, though I want to keep it all, everything I want.
You cannot do it. Clear applies on the entire window. You cannot do it. Okay? Is that clear? Next. Exit. Close the terminal. Whenever you're logged into server machine, always try to exit out of it. It will log you out of the server machine and you can come out of it. Okay? So exit is a command that will clear the window. Next command is cal. It will give you the current calendar, current month calendar. CAL is a command that will give you current month calendar. If I need to find out the current year calendar, all I need to say is cal space 2015. It will give me the current year calendar. Cal space year. Cal 01 2015. January 2015's calendar. Cal space 01 space 2015. So I'm just trying to show you guys different combinations how we could get a date.
So this will not give us the calendar of any previous year or future.
It will give us. I'm gonna do it. Cal.
I want to get
1947. That was the year.
In the past, I think like January or August, not likely to be the year. I mean, if I want to January or I want to August, not June or May, can I get it? Only 2 months, is 2 months not June.
Specifically only those 2 months, no.
Only 2 months.
No. So August 15th. In 1947 was a Friday. This is 1947's calendar. August 15th.
But you can't get a particular month.
I did get a particular month, right? 08-1947.
Only 1 month? Cannot get 2 months together?
No.
Cal minus 3. Previous month, current month, next month. Cal minus 3. Previous month, current month, next month. Cal minus 4 doesn't work. It's only cal minus 3 that works. Cal minus 3 will give you previous month, current month, and next month. That's it. No other number works. At least that I know.
Okay.
give some fear in the cat.
It depends on the current month. Okay? There might be other combinations, you can try it out. But Cal is the command that gives you the calendar. Alright. Something like this timestamp. This date is the command that will give you the current timestamp. Date is the command that gives you the current timestamp. So if you remember, to underscore char, we displayed parts by parts of the date, right? We can display date part of it, time part of it. Similarly, using the date function, we could do that. If I add up something like this, date space plus percentile D. Plus percentile will remain same for everything. Depends on the character that I put here, the output will change. If I put date space plus percentile T, it will display time part of the date. This is capital. When I say case sensitive, yes, you have to put capital. If I put small d, it's displaying just the day. 07. I just put small d. It's giving me 07. That is the day. So capital and small has a different answer. There are a bunch of things that we could do. These are all the things that we could do. Using date plus D. And each one will give you different. So this is what you need. Plus small a or capital. I'm gonna send you guys these notes. Don't need to copy every single thing. But all you need to know is date is the command that gives you or display the current timestamp, and if you want to display specific parts of the date, then yes, we could do it using any of these additions. Is that clear? Now, the next command that we have is log name. I'm just clearing it. Log name is the command that gives me the current username. Whatever username that I logged in, that is the command that we use to find out the log name. Okay? Log name is the command that will give you the current username. I also talked about hostname. This is my IP address that I connected to. If you can look at here, localhost, that is the same thing that I have here, localhost. So hostname is the command that gives you the address that you connected to. Everything is one word. Hostname. Okay? Is that clear? So, generally if we have a doubt in any of the functions, what do we do? Typically, before Google, go to help. Something like, so there is something very related to help. So if you want to find or understand any command, how it works, what are the different options that we could do. So we have something that we could find in Unix, which is called a command called man, M-A-N. So this is a command that is related to help. What is the command that we discussed until now? PWD, let's say. Man PWD. So it will go give you or take you into the help directory. This is a help directory and give you complete details about the PWD command. Man and the command that you want to find. Man date. This is a date command. See, there are a bunch of other options than what we discussed. Percentile. For every alphabet, there is a different thing. Okay? So all you need to know is man is a command that will open up the help directory. It will define that particular function, how do we write it, what are the different options that we have for that particular function. But all you need to know is the command that you're trying to find, the helper. Okay? So, do you see a Unix prompt here anywhere on this page? You don't see Unix prompt. What did I say? You don't have to write any next command. You have to see Unix prompt. I don't see it here. That means I'm logged into the user manual here. Okay. So in order to get out of it, you have to click on Q. Q. So when you click on Q, it will quit and exit back to the screen. Q is a command that will quit and exit back you onto the screen. Now you see your dollar prompt again, wherein you can write your statements. Okay? This is a very good command that that will help you. There is nothing called woman or anything. There is only man command. Okay? Where are we logged in right now? How do we find it? PWD. This is where we are logged in. Current working directory. Okay. So now, we are done with the basic stuff. Next stuff is, the next command that we are going to discuss is ls. This command lists all the files and folders in the current working directory. Ls is a command that will list the files and folders in the current working directory. This is a very important command and the basic command that we'll be using in every Unix statement that we run. Because we should know what we have in that particular folder to work with. Right? So if you have a Windows machine, what do? You just log into that particular folder and see what we have and double click that one. If you do not know what we have in this particular folder, how do we work? So ls is a command that will help us find all the files and folders that we have in the current working directory. It will display. Let me write that statement. So I'm in Krishna Training 1 right now. You might not have the same files and folders that I have because I've been working on it and I update the files here. But you will have basic folders. ls and enter. I just typed ls and enter. I see a bunch of names here. Every single thing is a file and a folder. I'll show you the difference between what file is and what. Q. Press Q. That's what I'm telling. Press Q. Okay. ls is a command I'm repeating it again. It displays all the files and folders. So you'll have the files and also folders. So this is a nice Unix user interface. That's why you can say what is a file, what is a folder. But generally you cannot say it in this command. So anything that is in this black is a file. Anything that is in blue is a folder.
So is that true universally?
That's what I'm telling. Okay. This is a nice Unix user interface. That's why you could see it. But it typically, this is not the way you see it. In this way, in this method, everything that is like this in bold, that is directories, and these are files. But there is other way. I'll tell you the actual way. How do we find a file in a folder? Okay. So there is an addition that you need to make. These are all the files and folders, but we don't know what is a file, what is a folder, what is a file, what is a directory. I'll start using the word directory. What is the size of it? What are the permissions that we have for it? So if you need to find when was that created, all the detailed information of every single folder. In Windows, what do we do? Let's say... This is ls. Consider this output, whatever you see, as ls. There are commands which are going to give us this details. What is the size, type, date modified, name, and the access. So this is called detailed information. But this is just list. Clear? Can you spot the difference between both of them? Let's go here. ls is the command that will list everything, but we want the output to be displayed in a different way so that it details everything. That is minus l. ls space minus l. ls minus l, that's what we call. ls space minus l. For every file or a folder, it has one line assigned to it. So if you look at here, these are all the details. It's going to give the permissions here. User, group, others.
Every file and folders.
Everything will be here. Folder, size, date it was created, and the file name. I'll explain. User, group, others, folder, size, create date, and the file name. Okay, so these are all the things that you know until now. Whatever we discussed until now is in this. In order to differentiate between a file and folder, file and directory, if there is a hyphen here, it is a file. If it is D, it's a directory. Not this. Only these things. These are some other junk numbers, probably serial numbers or something, I don't know. When they have it, but all we need to worry is file, directory, the access, the folder. I don't know what this is to. They have multiple times, but this is folder, size, create it, and the name of the file or folder. Okay. Is that clear? You can find any file. So there are a bunch of variations again in this one too. In ls. So let's say we just discussed ls, right? Ls minus l. So ls minus capital R displays all the directories and files and subdirectories in your folder. So everything. So now, let me clear this. LS displays all the files and folders in this current working directory, isn't it? In the current working directory. Do you think we'll have any folders in desktop? We might have. In this folder, in this directory, we might have some other directories too. But LS doesn't display that. It will just display only files and folders in the current working directory. I'm not in desktop folder. I'm in /home/krishna21. Isn't it? In this folder, whatever we have, that are the only things that will display. We can have multiple stuff in a directory. We are not concerned about it. Use with the ls function. Okay, ls minus l also does the same stuff. It's going to display only desktop. It's not going to go in detail about what we have in desktop. But if we have ls minus capital R, it's going to go in detail about what we have in each different folders. Okay, in desktop we have something. So in Herndon we have all these files. So that's how. File, folder, until the root. All its childs will also be displayed. Okay? That can be done using ls minus capital R.
What does R stand for?
It displays everything. I don't know the definition for this one, exactly what R stands for, but it displays all the directories. So ls minus l, long list, ls minus r in reverse order. This is sorting. What does that mean? Ls minus r. If I do ls, everything is in ascending order. A to D. This is how. Alphabets. This is how it's going until Z. Yes? If I do ls minus r, it starts from Z and ends with A. It displays it in reverse order. Can we display long list in reverse order? How do we display long list?
Ls minus
l. Can we display ls minus l in reverse order? Ls minus lr. This is displayed in reverse order. Ls minus lr. L displays long list, r displays it in reverse order. Okay? How do you exit from where?
I have this page that I want to clear.
Do you see dollar prompt?
Yeah, it's not.
Do you see dollar prompt?
Yeah.
Can you type command clear?
Yeah, it's not.
Click on the screen again and then. Command
not found.
It is case sensitive. You are usually using capital letters.
Okay. So there are a bunch of other things that you could do here. So go through them and see what how it works and what it does. I can tell you what this does. Display all the directories that starts with P. Capital P. Let me clear this one. ls. These are all the files and folders that I have. Ls, what do you want to display? All the files and folders that starts with small r. Let's say small r, start. It starts from here. Everything. What is it? Sort by what? There's something here, right? Timestamp. Minus t. Okay. Is this easy when compared to SQL? Lot? Simple, right? Yeah. What is it? Of course, yes.
You're going to send this list out to us, right?
Yes. Okay, the next command that we have is password. If you want to change a password, it's passwd. It changes the password. Passwd. It's going to ask me for the current password. I give it. Then it's going to ask me for the new password. I'm not going to do anything now. Okay. Passwd is the command that will help you to change the password. History. Next command is history. So it's going to give me all the commands that I've been working, the last 1,000 commands that I'm working. Is the history last command that I worked today? Password was the password was here, ls, r star. All the previous commands that I worked will be stored until 1,000 commands. So if I add a list, after some time, it's going to crunch down to last 1,000 commands. Okay? History is a command that will tell us all the commands that we worked with. History. Run this, you'll see it. Okay? And let me clear it. Ls is a command that will display all the files and folders. Now let's start creating folders and playing with some data. Okay. So mkdir is the next command. It makes directory. Mkdir is a command that will help us create the directories. Okay? So the way we write it is mkdir space folder name. I'll say weekend 136. Press enter. If your command executes completely fine, if there is no error, then you get back the Unix prompt, or else it will throw an error and then gives you the command prompt. There is no status message or something that shows me that there's an error. So I assume that there is a folder created. How do we find if the folder is created or not?
LS.
Type in ls, you should see weekend 136 created. Right? So mkdir space folder name creates the folder, the directory, empty directory. It creates an empty directory. We have no files in that directory. Okay? Were you able to do it, everybody? stop me if you need time to create those things. Okay. Clear until now? So until now, whatever we did only in our current working directory, our home folder, right? We never went out of that particular folder. We still have the tilde sign here. That means we are still in our home folder, and the current working directory is this, isn't it? Now we created a folder called weekend136. So I want to save some files in it. In order to save or create new files in that particular folder, I have to log into that particular folder and then create it. Okay. When I created a make directory weekend136 directory, did I specify a folder? Where should it create this folder? I never specified any folder, because when I execute these commands, when I create any new file, any new folder, it always creates in the current working directory by default. There is no way that you can create it in any other folders. If you want to create a file and folder in a particular folder, you have to log into that particular folder and then create it. Okay, so I was logged into this folder. So when I executed this, it created in the same folder. If I need to create another file or a folder in weekend136 directory, first I need to log into that particular folder and then create it. From here, sitting in this particular folder, I cannot create anything inside weekend136 folder. Make sense? So first step is, if you want to create or play with any data in one of the folders, you have to log into that particular folder, then do it. Is that clear? So now, in order to log in order to change the directory, the command is cd. A very important command. The next important command after ls is cd. Cd is the command which helps you to change the directory. Cd space directory name that you want to log into. What is it here? WE136. Right? So WCD136. Now look at here. Until now, what we have is this symbol, this tilde symbol, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now once I run this one, it should change it to weekend136. Did it do it? It did it. That is one way of saying that I'm in this particular folder right now. But the other way of finding it is what?
On the card.
To see if I'm logged into this folder or not. How do I know?
PWD.
Will give me the path of my current working directory. I've logged into home, Krishna Training 1, 136, which is correct. Isn't it? Yes? So cd is the command that will help me to log into a folder. Fine? Do I have any files here? How do I know?
LS.
Type in ls. I do not have any files, that's why no output was there. I just returned the Unix prompt back. That means there are no files or directories in that particular folder.
But here,
tilde.
The symbol is not there.
That's why. Because I was logged into 136 folder, now I'm logged, I'll be seeing 136. This is where I am. I'll be having tilde only if I'm in my home directory. This is my home directory. I'm not here. I'm in this folder right now. That's why I've logged in. Whatever folder I log in, that is the folder it shows here. Okay? Now, I do not have any folders here. Fine? I'll create a folder. Make directory. W1 space W2 space W3. Empty what?
MK.
No, it's just for folders. I'm creating directories here. I'm not creating files here. It's folders that I'm creating, directories. So I used a command mkdir w1, w2, w3. What does this mean? If I run this one, I created only one folder. If I run this one, I'll create three folders. If I type ls, will I see anything?
Yes.
I'll see w1, w2, and w3. Is that right? So if I need to log into w1, what do I do?
Change
that. If I type pwd, where am I right now? If I type pwd, what is the output that I get?
/wp/w136/w1.
No. Same stuff. Because you are in that particular directory. Is that clear?
No. For here, it's pwp equal to running, right? When we give new commander, then the second line we use this plus pwp. That means pwp here. That means one whatever give the commander.
Not understanding your question.
Okay.
Tell me. That's okay.
I mean pwp make xqp. Like running, right?
Why are you running?
What you write, new command here.
What does pwd do, first of all?
Oh, okay,
got it. So I'm in where? This particular folder. If I need to go back to Krishna training again, Krishna training 1, I need to go back now. So cd space file name will always take you forward. If you need to go back a folder, it's cd space dot dot. Cd space dot dot will take you one step backward. Where should I be? One step backward?
136.
Am I getting that?
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. CD dot dot. I'm getting back my symbol, which means I'm in this folder right now. Isn't it? Any questions until now? Okay. Now, I'm going to go back. If I need to go back to W1, what should I do?
CD space W1.
Do we have W1 folder in Krishna Training 1?
So CD space W1.
Enter, then we go to write CD space W1. We are executing multiple commands in order to go to multiple folders, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of doing multiple commands, if my path is going forward or backward, I can use it using root. So cd space we136. After I log into this one, next go to w1. I directly log into w1. So log into this, then log into this. I think so. Never saved it. I think we can. Okay. Make sense? So going forward, we can do this way. Can we come back the similar way? If I need to go back to Krishna training, what did I do? CD dot dot, again CD dot dot. Can I come back the similar way? Multiple times at a time? Can I do CD space dot dot slash dot dot? Can I do this? I can, obviously. So what did it do? CD dot dot, will it take you back to? So let me clear this. I'm in Krishna training 1. CD space WE136/W1 type PWD. This is where I am right now. Okay? If I do CD dot dot slash dot dot PWD. So now, first I was in Krishna training 1, then I did CD W1. If I type PWD, it took me from Krishna training to this one, and then it took to this one directly in one single statement. Similarly, if I want to come back, I did this one. So CD dot dot will take me from W1 to 136, and another dot dot will take me from 136 to Krishna training 1. So when I type PWD, that is what I see.
So you can use root for as many folders, if there's folder inside a folder inside a folder.
Yes. I'm in W1 right now again. If I need to log into WE36, W3, we have three folders, right? W1, W2 and W3. If I need to log into W3, what is the typical way? I'm in W1 right now.
CD dot dot.
We'll take you back one step.
And then
CD W3 will take you into W3 folder. Isn't it? That works. CD dot dot slash W3. CD dot dot will take you one step backward. We are in this folder right now. Here we have W1, W2 and W3. I want to log into W3. We are in the W3 now. CD is a command that will change the directory. All you need to remember is that. Okay? Is that clear? Any doubts? So PWD, I'm in my folder, so let me go back to my W1 folder.
How do you do this?
Alright, do it magic.
How do you do the magic?
Just click the arrow marks, it will give you the previous commands.
Mm-hmm.
Click the upper arrow, it will give you all your previous commands, whatever you executed. Alright, next. We are in W1 folder right now. Yes? In this folder, everybody, guys, these are all tricks. First learn C Unix, then tricks. So we are in W1 folder right now, and here I want to create a file. Until now what we created was directories. Let us create an empty file. Empty file has what? Just the name, nothing inside it. Okay. In order to create an empty file, the command is touch. Touch is a command that creates an empty file with a current timestamp. Touch is a command that will create an empty file with a current timestamp. So I'm in LS, W1 right now. I type LS Do I see any file? No, because the directory is empty. I do not see any file. So now, all I'll try to do is, I'll say touch F1, some file, enter. There is no error, that means something happened back in the function. So type ls, I'll see one file. So I just created a empty file. How do I know if it's empty or not?
See the details of it.
See the details of it, I'll find it. ls minus, L will give you the long list of that particular file. So there is one file, which is called F1, and the size is 0, which is created at that particular time, Feb 7, 8:35. Okay? Is this fine? So, to create an empty file, the function is touch. We can create multiple files. Touch F2 space F3 space F4 space F5. It will have 5 empty files. Folder is mkdir, make directory. Touch is a command that will create the empty file. There are other commands coming, the next couple of things that we're going to discuss. There are other commands that also creates the empty file, but touch is one of it. It just creates the empty file with the current timestamp. Fine? Next. The next important command is cat, C-A-T. Cat is a command that will help us to read or edit a file. Okay, it also helps us create an empty file. We can create an empty file using this one too. But cat is a command typically to read the data in a file. Okay? If you have a file, we want to read what we have in the file. We use the command cat. How do we do it? Do we have any data in F1? If I say cat F1, what should be the output? Nothing. Okay? So, we'll do some other tasks here with which we can add data to these files. Some data, some random text. And we'll see if cat works or not. Okay? Cat F1, this function will read the file F1. We do not have any data, that's why it's not returning anything. So if we have a data, this will generate return. So if we, what do we need to insert data into a file? What should we do? We using the cat function, I can say cat greater than, use the greater than symbol, and F1. Instead of just cat F1, I'll say cat greater than F1. So when I press enter, it will take me into the file and ask me to enter data. So what I'm trying to do, I have an empty file, I'm trying to insert data into that empty file. Okay? To do that, I'm doing cat greater than F1. Do I see Unix prompt here now? I pressed enter. Do I see Unix prompt? That means I'm in the folder right now. I cannot execute any other commands until I finish editing and come out of it. I'm going to do it again. PWD, I'm in this folder. LS, I have 5 files, empty files. Right? I'll say cat greater than F1. When I type this, it's going to take me into the file right now. I'm in the file. I can edit the file right now. Let's say this is Krishna training. Okay? I entered my text here. Right? And I need to save and come out of it. In order to save and come out of it, you have to press Ctrl plus D. D as in David. Control, hold the Ctrl key and press D. It will save it and come out of it.
What happens if you do Ctrl S? Unless it does not.
I don't know what it does. Ctrl D saves and quits. That's how I know.
Okay.
It's not saving. It's not Word document that you see. It's not Microsoft Word that we're working in. Unix. So Ctrl D is a term that will save and close the editing window. How do I know? I got back my Unix prompt. Fine. Now if I say cat F1, is the file empty?
No,
we have some data. So if I type enter, I should see the text that I have in the file. I should be able to read the file now. Isn't it? Try it. Try doing that. What is it? Huh?
Can you ask something?
I want everybody to try it.
I made a mistake. I only want to clear some of the zone, not every nine.
What is it?
If I use clear, I go back to it. Is there any way to just clear like 2 or 3 9, not go back to the top?
What did I say? What does clear do? It just scrolls down the screen. Go back here, scroll the screen up. You will see all your previous statements. Scroll your screen up. You will see all your previous statements. Scrolling. It doesn't delete anything. You still have those statements. Okay?
For me,
because you haven't typed enter. Because you haven't typed enter. After you finish typing, this is Krishna training or whatever text, you just did Ctrl D. Type enter, and that is okay. It's fine. Okay? Does everybody have it? Yes or no? So cat greater than F1 will add. So let me add some data to cat F2. So what do I do? Same stuff. Cat greater than F2. Enter. It's going to take me into the document now. I'll say first line, second. Third line, enter, Ctrl D, I came out of it. I'll say cat F2 will display the data. Is that fine? That's my next thing that I'm going to discuss. Okay? You guys have it?
My file is...
What happened to your file?
I just put the control D. When it's coming first place, then all this.
What is that?
It's coming again, starting. Whatever I got, it's coming to
me. Can you show me?
I have everything wrong.
So I can redo the things that I did. I'm in right now. W1, right? So I'm gonna go back to my W2 folder. I don't have any files here in W2. You know how to create an empty file. What did I do?
Touch.
I can do it with touch, or I can just slightly do it with cat. I told you there are multiple functions to do it, right? So cat greater than F1 or F6. Do I have a file called F6 in W2 file folder? W2 has nothing, right? So even then I can still do it. Cat greater than F6. This will create an empty file and then ask you to enter the data. Okay? So now I'll say CDE, some data, Control D. I save and come out of it, type in ls, I'll see a file called F6 with this data. Isn't it? Cat F6, will show the data, that this is the data that I have in that particular folder. Okay. Done. Copy. Still didn't get it? Give me your laptop. Bring it here. So now whatever we created until now was, if we have an empty file, log into that empty file and insert data. Or create an empty file using cat function and then edit the data. Yes, these are the two scenarios that we did. Now, I need to add data to this one, whatever I have here. I need to add some more data to it. So if I can do cat, editing is what? This is right? And F6, enter. I'll add 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to the above data. This is what I have initially in cat 6. Control D, cat F6. What did it do? It just have the data that I entered here. It overwrited complete data. Yes? So there is no way that you can insert data using cat greater than. If you want to insert data, so if you have data in a file and you want to add data to the existing file, then the function is cat greater than F6. Two greater than symbols. So this will not overwrite anything. It will just embed the data, whatever you are trying to insert, into the existing file. So now I'll put A, B, C, D, and Control D, do cat F6, add the complete data. I add data to an existing file. I do not overwrite it now. So cat greater than is the command that will give you or insert data in the existing file. All right.
Can we edit?
Not with Unix. There is something called VI editor. Using VIATA you can do it, not with what we have here. Is this clear? Cat? So cat is a command that will help us read and edit the files. Okay, for editing it will be greater than. If you want to add data to existing file without overwriting, then greater than and greater than. Fine? Am I right now? So the next command that we have is cp. Cp is the command that will help us to copy files and have a new timestamp, and can have a new timestamp. So how do we do it? So let's say I have a file ls minus l here, or let me go back. So I'm in W1 folder right now, and I have 5 files. Yes? F1, F2, F3, F4, and F5 that I created initially. Let's say I want to copy F2 into something called F6, a new file. I want to create a new file. In that new file, I want to copy the data that I have in F2. You guys with me here? So all I need to do is cp F2 copy to F6. So if I type ls minus l here, I created a file F6 with the current timestamp. Yes? The current timestamp. Whatever data that I have in F2 has been copied to F6. Copying one file to another file, and the copied file will have the current timestamp, this timestamp. Copy. CP, file that you want to copy into where you have to copy. So this is the file that I want to copy into this file. So cp is another command to create an empty file. How do you think we can do it? Empty file. If you have an empty file, can I copy, if I copy it into another file, will it be empty?
It should be.
That's how we create another empty file.
Wait, does it need a commander or do we need a I9?
What is it?
I say, when we write CP like F2, F6, do we need a high nine,
run to run it?
Yeah.
No. Enter is what you need. Okay? If you want to rename a file, the command is mv. So mv, old file name and new file name. So I'll say I want to change the file name of F6. I'll say mv space F6, name it to, tell me a different name, B1, ls minus l, F6 is gone and it's been converted to B1. So mv is a command that will help to rename a file.
When you rename a file, does it affect the data as well?
No. Why will it affect the data?
the time that we see, the timestamp, we see when it was created but not modified.
Yes. Okay? Are you able to do it? Everybody? So the next command is chmod. So whatever we discussed early in the class about permissions, assigning the permissions, sending out the permissions, all those things can be achieved through chmod. So chmod is a command function that will help us change the permissions of a file. How do we do it? These are the three things that we need: plus, minus, and is equal to. Plus will add a permission, minus will remove the permission, is equal to will assign the permission. I'll tell you what assign is, what is the difference between plus and assign. You guys know all this stuff, right? Read, write, execute, the denominations and everything. If you do not want to give user, group, others separately, all you need to do is all. Okay, now as we discussed, 754 is what? 7 means R plus W plus X. 5 means R plus W. 4 means write and execute is what? Just read is R, right? In order to assign permissions, let's go here. We have these permissions on these files, right? Already. I'll pick one of the file and we'll play with it. So chmod of 756. What does this mean? User will have all the permissions.
Read and execute.
Read and execute.
And read and write.
Read and write. So file F5, chmod, change mod, the access this way to that particular file. Yes? If I run it, there is no error that it wrote. That means it might have did something. I'll do ls minus l. F5 have been changed. You can see the color. Can you see the permissions now? Did it change the way we wanted it? Yes. First is 7, which will have all the permissions. 5 means read plus execute, R and X. 6 means read and write, R and W. Did it do it the way we wanted it? Is everybody fine with it? So that is how we can change the permissions of a file. If I want to do it the other way, chmod of, we have user, group, and other, those denominations, right? Whatever we did was, until now was with numbers. 756 is after we add everything, that's how we get 7, yes? Now if I want to do it separately, just for the user, just for the group, all I can do is user, let's say, let's say I need to remove execute access for user, minus X. X is what? Execute. For what file? F5. If I do this, come on, I'll be removing execute access to the user. U is what? First three characters are related to user. First three, user, group, and others. You have to remember that. There is no way, or I cannot hard code it in your brains. You have to remember it. Or if you want to do it the other way, chmod you are a generous person and you want to give read, write, execute to others. Oh, what do we need to do? Plus X, isn't it? Others, we are adding the execute access. We have only two, read and write. So if you want to add anything, it is equal to, sorry, plus. If you want to add anything, it is plus on file. If I do ls minus l now, others have read, write and execute. Is that clear?
Yeah.
So we tried minus, removing the access. We tried giving the access. So what is this equal to? Chmod. If you do not want to mess up with all the pluses and minuses, all you need to do is for user assign rwx. Whatever you have, all the properties, it just hard removes everything and overwrites it with whatever properties that I have here, R, W and X on F5. Because I'm changing the permissions, that's why. Okay? Questions? So that is what we do with chmod. Okay? Is this clear? Now,
question about if we have met, as you mentioned, u is equal to rwx, at the same time, can we use space and mention it for group and for others?
Yes.
Just add by spaces.
It works. Add this way. Put a comma and add it. Now, clear? chmod? The next step is, let me open that up. We created a lot of junk files. You do not want all these junk files. You want to remove them. Now this is the command that will help us delete files, not the directories. Delete files. Rm is a command that will remove files. F4. Type in ls minus l. I do not see F4 anymore. Rm is a command that will help us delete the files. Just like that. What if you want to remove multiple files? Rm, F4 or F. F2. It will delete multiple files. Okay. Let me log into another folder, W2. Type in ls. Or let me go back. Right, I'm in this folder W1 and we have all the files. Agree? Now, let's say I want to delete all the files that starts with F. Everything that I want to delete with F. All I need to do is rm F star. Everything that starts with F will be deleted. Is that clear? So similarly, if you want to delete a directory, rmdir, remove directory, is the function. So we do not have any directories in W1, so I'm going to go one step backward. I'm in WE136. If I do ls here, I see three folders, right? Three directories. And here I'm going to execute the rmdir function. Let's first delete W3. Do we have any files and folders in there? How do we know? Log into W3 and check. I have no files and folders in W3. Okay. Let me know once you get it. I said done copying. I'm going to repeat whatever I said. Hello? Ready? Ready to listen? Now, what did I tell? RMDIR is the function that will delete the directories. Now, first thing is, let me see where I am right now. I'm in WE136. Let me check what are the commands that I have. Files and directories, that is W1, W2 and W3 are the files and folders that I have in. I know W3 is empty, W2 has one file and W3 has some other files, right? Let's first delete W3. rmdir space W3 will delete the, if I delete it, did it throw an error? No. That means it might have deleted it. It did delete. Yes? Let me delete W2. RMDIR W2. What is it saying? It's saying the folder or the directory is not empty. So RMDIR command is the function that will delete empty directories. If you have data in the directory, you cannot delete that folder using rmdir. rmdir is a command that will delete empty directories. Is that clear? Just remember that rmdir is a function that will delete only empty directories. Okay? But if somebody wants me to delete all the files and folders, even though we have data, that is done using rm. rm minus r removes directories with content inside it. So initially what did we discuss? Rm is a file, is a function that will delete files, right? If you want to delete a folder which has data in it, then we have to again come back to rm. Using RMDIR, there is no way that you can delete a directory which has data in it. Okay. RMDIR function removes directories, but it removes only empty directories. I need you guys to remember it, because people get confused here. When they try to remove directories, they always try to use RMDIR, but this command will delete only empty directories. If you want to delete a directory which has data in it, you have to again use rm space minus r. So that is the thing that activates removing directories with the data. Fine. And rm minus ir, minus I is the thing that adds the confirmation. If you delete something, it will ask, do you want to delete it? Yes or no, right? So that is the confirmation it asks for IR. So let's run these two functions. I have these two files here, right? W1 and W2. Let me run it. W1 and W2. Each one has one file. So let's remove one with the direct without asking permission, one with asking permission. So we'll do first RM minus R folder W2. Right? It's not going to ask me for any permissions. It just will delete everything. If I type ls, W2 is gone. Initially with RMDIR, it was throwing an error because it was not empty. Is that clear? Now, it didn't ask me for any permission here. Now, if I need to ask for permission, I say rm minus ir W1. Type in enter. If I type yes, yes, come on, remove it. So it's going to ask for every single thing. You want to delete that particular file, remove the directory, everything, yes, 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 for every single step. And when you say yes, if you type ls, you see no folder in that particular folder. Everything will be deleted. Can you guys spot the difference between RM and RMDIR? Yes. How to copy a directory? I don't think we can copy a directory.
One more question. You said that.
Because I tried CPDIR.
No, no, it will. CPDIR? Don't invent functions. CP is the command that will only do for files. You cannot copy folders that way. What is the question?
You said that we can delete files based on the first letter of the file name. Can we delete files based on date they were created?
I think you might. Go and check in man command. There'll be options. Okay. We don't have any files here, so I'm going to go back to my home screen. ls, I have all my files and folders in my current working directory. That is my home path. Now there is a function called file. So this will give me the type of file that I'm working with. .txt is what? A text file. This is a PNG, photographic file, right? So if I need to find the format of the file, the type of the file, I'll say yes, say file BG. PNG image data file, and these are all the properties that we have for that particular file. File R2. It's empty, so it doesn't have anything. File. It's an ASCII text format file. So if you want to find what type of file that is, the command is file and give the file name. I'm just picking the files from here, from this list. I'll tell you what this is later, but for now, text files and PNG files. Clear until now? Okay. What is that? What is this file? What format is? Is it text file?
Last one.
This one.
Yeah, that's the one.
What is new? We're looking at it, yes. Or the type says Microsoft Word document. This is a JPEG image. This is an application. Or any other stuff here, right? There's a compressed folder. That is the type. So if you want to find, fine. Looking at this, if you do not have the image, there is no way that you can find it. So by looking at the names, you cannot find it. So by looking at the type, you find it. So file is a function that gives you this data. You give the file name, and it'll tell you what type of document that is, what type of file that is. So I went there, gave file.r2, it was an empty file. So file.pr4, there was some data in it. So it's just telling that it's a ASCII text file. Text file. I typed this one. It's a PNG data, image data file with this resolution, and that is the color contrast and everything. It just explains what type of file that is. Okay, is that clear? Cat is command for what? Read a file. Okay, there's a file called PR2 here. I have some data, cat PR2, some data here, some random chunk data. Don't worry about the data. All I'm explaining here is functions, which has around 14 lines, right? So the next command that we are discussing is head. So this is very important, this command for testing. If you want to display top 5 lines or top 10 lines of a file, then the command that we use is head. So head minus 10 of file name, PR2. It has 14 lines. This will display top 10 lines. I'll check. Okay. So the reason why it is important is, I can give you another reason here why we use Unix, why we learn Unix for a QA. So whenever we test something, I've told you that if there is an issue anywhere in the logs or anything, if there is an issue with anything, you just first log into logs. It can be any stuff. There'll be so you log into those logs and find out where exactly the mistake is, right? In Informatica, we can directly get the logs directly from there, from the workflows. But if you're doing some other testings, let's say you're testing a service, a web service, and there is a web log that runs every time a web service executes. And if there is an error in that web service, you have to log into the log, and those logs will be stored in a Unix machine. So you have to log into the machine, open up the log, and read it. How do you open up the log? You have to first navigate to that particular folder where the log is saved using CD, right? Then navigate to that particular file, open that file, look at it. You can do tail, you can do head, and display top 10 lines of the code and see do you have a mistake, or top 100 lines or top 200 lines, and scroll one by one and see where exactly the error is. That is all coding, don't worry about it. But when you guys had classes for services, web services, SOAP UI, did you guys do it already? Then this shouldn't be a new concept. If you guys are feeling that whatever I'm talking is completely new to you, and if you guys are already finished SOAP UI, then you might have to retake it. Because this is all related to web services, SOAP UI. You guys have done it already, right? Yeah, refer back to your notes. So head is a command that will give you top lines. So I can display 5 lines, 10 lines, depending on whatever I want to do, okay? Similarly, if I want to display last 5 lines or last 10 lines, 20 lines, 100 lines, the command is tail. And file name. So tail minus 10, PR2. PR2 is the file that I created. You might not have the file in your system, or you might. So if you do not have it, just create a file. How do you create it? Using cat, you can create a file which will have some enough data to test the head and tail functions. Okay, typically we generally use tail a lot because all the errors that you have in the file, we just go from bottom to see where exactly it failed. So tail is what we generally use to check the logs. Okay? Questions?
So we call commands or functions.
What is that? These are all functions, yes. Yeah. Unix commands, you can call it. So what it runs is, so what did I explain previously? Predefined functions, and you can create your own functions, right? You can call it commands too, different names. In Unix, we call it commands. But as I'm used to call function in SQL, you get that language. In Unix, we call them commands. Okay. Link, this is not very important, but I can tell you what. It's pretty simple. Well, let's say we have a file. We have another file. If you link two files together, if you edit this file, the other file will also be automatically edited. Okay. Let me create a file, cat s1 8 2 3 4 5. Delete. I took s1. I have only s1 here, so I'll say link s1 to s2. Type ls. I'll have two files. If I type ls minus l, size is exactly same. Whatever data that I have in L1, S1 is now moved to S2. Now, from here on, whatever I edit in S1, it should automatically link to S2. I'll say cat greater than, if I say cat greater than S1. I'll have 7890 control D. Cat S1 has this data, right? Cat S2 has also the same data. Did I edit anything in S2? I haven't edited anything in S2. All I edited was in S1. But I created a link earlier between S1 and S2. So if I add anything to S1, S2 will automatically be added. Yes. Existing links, I believe you can find it out with the DBAs to see what are the files linked to each other. But with what we know or what I know, I cannot find a link between two files. So all the time, if I want to create a link, I create it manually by my own. So if I have a data that changes every time, so I link a file from there to the file that I'm working with, so that I do not lose the data whatever it changes. So that is when we generally use linking concept. Okay.
And if we delete one of those files that we linked, the other will be automatically deleted.
If you want to delete a link, other hard ways, delete this file.
It will delete.
Yes. If you delete this one, the link will automatically be deleted. Okay. So. One of the main and important functions for an interview, there are a couple of important things what we discussed, but one of the main important questions that you'll be asked is fine. Find is a command that will help you to find the files and directories. It can be in current working directory or in any directory. Okay? Find is a command that will help you find a file or a directory. Now, what do we have in this one? So we start with the Unix prompt, right? In Unix prompt, find is the command that we have. Next is period. So this is how it is written. This is all the explanation that I have. Okay. This is the only way we write it. That is the only line that we have for the function. So dot in this one specifies the working folder. Where exactly it should search for that file and folder. Okay. Dot specifies where exactly it should search for it. I'll explain this one. Name, this is a syntax that you need to have. If you're searching for a name, you have to have minus name. This way. And the file that you're trying to search for, space minus print. Okay? These are all the things that you should have. Let's start writing that one. Try to search something. Clear. ls cd dot dot. I'm in this folder right now. I want to find if R7 is available or not. Let's pick some example and try and do it. So find space dot space minus name. What is the file name that I'm searching?
R7
space minus print. If we have it, it will be shown. Let's change the name. Let's say I don't have it. Is R8 available in the folder? No. Let me search it. If you do not have any file or folder available with that particular name, there will be no output display. Okay? Let's go to man and find. You have bunches and bunches of data. How about find? If you have time, if you want to read this one, you can always play around with it. Don't worry about it. I'm just showing you that. I'm just revising. I just jump around with different functions so that you know that we have all those functions. You remember that. So man is again a function that will give you the what? User manual. So find is a function that will help us find a file or a directory in a directory. So here I put dot, right? So if you want to specifically search for a file in a particular folder, all I can do is find. If you do not want to search it everywhere else, I'll say slash home slash Krishna training 1 slash WE136. Space. Minus name. S1. Space. Minus print. Is that right? Is it available? Yes, it is. If it's not available, do we have S3? No, right? I don't have any file that's named with S3 in this particular folder. You guys know at least what are the files that I have in this folder? S1 and S2, right? If I try to search for S3, I don't find it. So I can search it in the directory completely, or I can go to a specific folder and then search it. Instead of dot, this is what I specified. I'm telling the find function to go directly to this folder and then search. If you do not want this, I can put dot. So if I put dot, let me put S1. Put dot. What is it doing? Still showing. Right? So dot works on the entire thing. Try to search for that file entirely and see if this file exists in this folder's folder, directories. It will search for everything and then find for that particular file. Okay? So find. What is it?
I just said ls minus f, the file name. It is a file that you're searching.
Ls minus f?
Yeah.
Okay.
Space S1. Space S1. S1. Then if it's a directory, I say minus d.
What does ls do? It will show the list of files and folders in the current working directory. S1 is not in this folder. It's in a different folder. I have to log into that folder and then search it. Isn't it easy with find? In find, am I specifying anything here? I'm searching it globally. You cannot do that with ls. Okay? So find does that. Any questions? And there are a bunch of other variations that I've noted down here. So when you get this document, take a look at it and try and do some searches based on what we have here. So, but this is the basic stuff. So we can search all the text that we have. So dot instead of minus name, I'm just searching by type. Okay, I'll say star.txt. I'm not having name because I'll have name only when I'm searching with the file name. If I do not have a file name, I'll search differently. Find text files and print the data that you see in that text file. Okay? So try to make sure you go through every one of this. I'm going to send it out right away after the class. But this is important. Find, they will have a question on this if you go to a SQL interview. SQL interview consists of both SQL and Unix questions. Unix is also important. Okay? Com and CMP. These two file comments are used to compare files. You're never going to do anything in Unix, the comparison, never. It'll be pretty hard for you to test anything in Unix. I never tested a file, but there are commands which does it. So if I do CMP, the output is always in bytes. It compares the data with the size, which you do not care. Okay, if you are interested, just run some commands and see how the output looks, but always the output is in bytes. We want the difference in file, right? We don't need the size difference. So CMP is a fine command that will display the common values in one line. So try and play with these two functions, and if you have time, you can do it today after the class and come back tomorrow and ask me if you have a doubt on these two things. But as I said, we never compare anything in Unix, so I feel it's a waste of time learning these commands. Two files. You compare two files. Let's say you have a source file and target file. You say com source file space target file. It will compare. It depends on the requirement. See, at least I know that if there is something called sort. Do you know if there is something that sorts the data in SQL? Do you memorize it? How do you know there is something called order by? You do it regularly. You have a requirement, and you know that SQL. When you learn it, well, at least once, you should be able to understand. I don't say by heart doesn't help. I by heart all the commands. If I don't know what that does, it's of no use for me. So I go by requirement. If I have a requirement, I at least should know that these are all the possibilities that I have in Unix, that I have in SQL. If I want to display some part of the string, how do you know? Did you by heart? I don't have an answer for that one too. So when you practice, you get it. So it totally depends on the requirement. I go by requirement. I do not by heart any function. But I know syntax for every single function. If somebody asks me to write a syntax for substring, I can write it anytime. I do not need to refer a book to write a syntax for substring. Yes, if somebody asks me a complex command in Unix, I will refer a book. Because I'm not a Unix guy, I'm a SQL guy. But I know Unix, whatever I need for. If I need to log into a remote machine, copy files, put some files, all the basic stuff, all the syntaxes I do know. But if Unix is a big chunk. We just train here whatever we need for a QA. So all these functions, whatever we've built up, mostly these are the functions that we'll be using. You ask anything from this function, yes, I'm thorough. But other functions, there are a lot of DBA functions, which is a complete different chapter. You cannot memorize all those. I don't even know if I can do that. Okay? If somebody asks me to assign him some permissions, these are not the permissions that I'm talking about. If you go into a company and I've told you first thing, right? We have to assign, we have to be granted the access to access, actually get into the system. If we want to log into the that computer's, that company's laptops, you have to be first sent into the system. So in order to access those systems, they have to create your user account, they have to give you your password and everything. I don't even know if what are the commands they'll use to create your account. How do we, that is all a DBA job. And that is done in Unix too. So there are a bunch of other commands which I'm not aware of. If somebody asks me a question from that, I cannot say anything.
I heard from some computer guy say that if you know basically Unix, once you find a job, your job is pretty stable because Unix right now.
Those are the 50, there are around 30 or 40 commands that we're going to discuss in the class. That is Unix. And it is pretty stable. It doesn't change anything. If there is an issue, you can log into the logs, find out what that issue is, restarting the server, those type of stuff. That is all you do. Maintaining the databases.
So how about it is Saturday?
I don't know. Don't. We are in Unix class. Talk about that. I'll send you this file. Why do you worry about it? COM and CMP, right? You guys don't want to do anything yourself. You guys have to practice. When do you learn? If you don't do it. Tell you just now. What do you want to import?
From another system or something like that.
I haven't discussed it yet. If I use COM, the common values from both the files will be on one side. The matches, the values that are not matched will be on the other side. Everything until here. These are all the unmatched values from both the files. These are the matched values from both the files. So that will be on one line, this will be another line. Matched values and unmatched values. CMP, S1, S3. You guys understand? That's why I didn't explain. Even I don't understand. It is in data, bytes. That EOF means some code in Unix, which explains what is the difference in sizes.
So the 1 to 3 is the data in S1 or the byte in
One second. So, S1 has this data, 1 to 0. S3 has 3, 4, 5, 6. If I do com of S1, S3, unmatched records from first one, matched records from both the files, sorry, 3, 4, 5, I don't have 6 in the first one. And the unmatched records from the, so this is file 1, 1, 2, 7, 8, 9. These are unmatched from S1. This is unmatched from second file. These are the matched records. First file doesn't have 6. Second file has 3, 4, 5, 6. When I'm comparing S1 and S3, the first line will be all the unmatched records in file 1. 1, 2, 7, 8, 9. Second file will be unmatched records from the second file. This is the only file number that is not available in this list. That is 6. 3, 4, 5. Are the only matching records that we have in both the files. It will be displayed in different lines. Is it useful to test? I never felt it useful. Okay? So that is how the data will be interpreted here. And the last function before we class today, close today is sort. Or else we'll do it tomorrow. Sorry. So tomorrow first hour, I believe we can wrap up Unix. First one and a half hour. So be here on time. And we'll come up with these questions and test. I'll answer all these questions, whatever you have here. SARP schema, Snowflake schema, BI reports, ETL workflow. I need this data. Different transformations. If you guys don't give me, I'm not going to tell you any function, any transformations that I'll come up with. I need everybody to answer this question. Whoever comes in tomorrow. I need 10 transformations, no matter how you get it, where you get it. I need different transformations from everybody. I do not want you guys to copy. Try and do research, whatever you do. If you guys do not give me transformations tomorrow, I'm not going to give you any transformations. You give me? It's a barter system. You give me some, I give you some.
So tomorrow you're going to finish unit.